Hello and welcome to this last video in our series When God is Calling People by Their Names. I would like to give you a short summary of what we have seen so far. We have started with Saul of Tarsus, and with Saul of Tarsus we have seen what the grace of God is able to accomplish in the life of a man. The grace of God has taken the greatest of all sinners and has made him a powerful servant of God in the New Testament. Saul asked these two questions: Who are you, Lord? And what shall I do, Lord? Everything started with grace. After this, we have looked at Simon Peter. Simon Peter trusted in his own strength and failed. He had to learn that in him, that is, in his flesh, dwelleth no good thing. But our advocate, the Lord Jesus, he restored Simon Peter to fellowship. And not only that, he even extended his ministry. After Simon Peter, we looked at Martha. And with Martha, we have learned about setting our priorities right. We have seen that the Lord Jesus is always more important than the things that we may do for him. Ministry flows out of fellowship with the Lord. Then we turned to Samuel. And with Samuel, we have learned about the importance of recognizing and listening to the voice of the Lord. We need to get acquainted with the voice of the Lord to follow him and to do his will. After that, we have seen Moses. Moses, who had received a special task from the Lord to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt, he felt very weak, but the Lord told him that he would be with him, and the Lord provided everything that Moses needed to accomplish his ministry. And in our last session, we have looked at Jacob. Jacob, the great supplanter, who tried to get God's blessing through fleshly means. And of course, that doesn't work out. God had to discipline him. Jacob had cheated others, and he was himself cheated by his own sons. He lived in a wrong reality for a long time. But God reached his goal even with Jacob. And at the end of his life, he was able to bless the mightiest man in the world and even to worship the Lord. Now today, I would like to read a passage from Genesis chapter 22, and we are going to look at Abraham. And it came to pass after these things that God tried Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Take now your son, your only son whom you love, Isaac, and get you into the land of Moriah, and there offer him up for a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will tell you of. Verse 9. And they came to the place of which God had told him, and Abraham built the altar there and piled the wood. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar up on the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. And the angel of Jehovah called to him from the heavens and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Stretch not out your hand against the lad, neither do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God and have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. With Abraham, we reach the peak of Christian maturity in application, we may say. Because with Abraham, we find perfect obedience and the willingness to sacrifice things for God. And this speaks about maturity in our life of faith. God asked Abraham to sacrifice the most precious thing that he had. Not his cattle, not his tent, not any material things, but his beloved son Isaac. And we have to imagine what that meant for Abraham. He had waited 25 years to receive Isaac as his son. And then God had given him wonderful promises who were all centered in Isaac. And now God asked him to put everything on the altar. What a test of faith for Abraham. But Abraham showed perfect obedience to the Lord, and God was glorified through the obedience of Abraham. Abraham really showed that he loved the Lord with all his heart because he was willing to give up something very, very precious to him for the Lord. And we may ask ourselves the question, do we love the Lord above all things? Or are there any things in our life that take the first place before the Lord? The Lord Jesus told his disciples that we should love the Lord above all things. And if anybody loves his own parents or his own children more than he loves the Lord, he is not worthy of the Lord. These are very challenging words, but this is what discipleship is all about, giving Christ the first place and the first priority in our lives. When did we sacrifice something that is precious to us for the Lord for the last time? Are we willing to do things like this? I mean, Abraham, he was called out of Mesopotamia. God appeared unto him and says, come out and leave your relatives and come to the place that I will show you. And Abraham was willing and he came out. What a step of faith. What about us? Are we willing to obey the voice of God if he is calling us to come and to go to a new place? Or what about our children? If God is calling our children to the mission field or to some dangerous ministry, are we willing to say, Lord, do with them whatever is pleasing to you? Abraham was willing to give his own son to the Lord. What a wonderful testimony he received. And you see, Abraham, because of his willingness to sacrifice, he was blessed by the Lord. It says in verse 17 and 16 already, it says, God says, by myself I swear that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will richly bless you. You see, if we are willing to give up something for the Lord, that is always connected with blessing. Because we will become more acquainted with the Lord. We will make experiences with the Lord. We will experience how he carries us through this period of sacrifice. And this gives us a new appreciation for his closeness, that he is with us. Abraham, he gave everything to the Lord. And by this, he was justified by works. I'd like to explain you what that means. We find two kinds of justification in the Word of God. The first kind of justification is justification by faith. And that's also what we see in the life of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, we read, Abraham believed God, and he reckoned it to him for righteousness. Abraham was justified before the Lord because he believed his words. He took God at his word and says, what you say is true. And that's why he was reckoned righteous. Now we are justified on the same principle because we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and we believe that if we confess our sins, he will forgive our sins. That's why we are justified before God. But there's also another kind of justification, that is justification before a man, before the world, before the people who can see us. God can look into our hearts and he will see that there is real faith. But the people who surround us, they cannot look into our hearts. They can only see the acts or the works of faith that come out of our hearts, and they will be visible in action. And that's exactly what we find in Genesis chapter 22. Now, in the epistle of James, James speaks about justification and he speaks about justification by works. Now, I'd like to read that passage here in James chapter 2. It says in verse 22, you see that faith wrought with his works, and that by works faith was perfected. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned him as righteousness, and he was called friend of God. You see that a man is justified on the principle of works and not on the principle of faith only. Now, this speaks about justification by the works of faith before the world. And you see, if we want to be a testimony for the Lord Jesus here in this world, we need to show works of faith. And we need to show by our actions that we obey God and that we love the Lord. And that's both what we find in the life of Abraham. When did we sacrifice something for the last time for the Lord Jesus? When did we obey him for the last time where it really costs us something? You see, that's where faith becomes visible in our lives. But what I love in the story of Abraham is that Abraham, he experienced the Lord in this test of faith in a very, very special way. And finally, he called the place where this happened Jehovah Jireh. And the meaning of this is the Lord will provide. The Lord will provide. Abraham, he realized that with every test that the Lord allows to happen, God will supply and he will provide what is necessary. And now we come back to the first person that we have considered in this series, and that is the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul, at the end of his life, he could speak something that was very similar to what we have just seen with Abraham. He says, the Apostle Paul says to the Philippians in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, "But my God will abundantly supply all your need according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus." You see, that was a mature Christian, someone who had learned who God is and how God is. And that's what God desires for our lives as well. May he get the first place in our lives. May we learn to live by grace. May we give him the first priority in all things. May we learn to listen to his word, to his voice. May we accept his discipline if it is necessary. But may we also come to the point that we are willing to obey without compromise and to sacrifice things that are precious to us. The Lord will be with us and he will be glorified. Now I hope that you have been blessed through this video series. If you have not yet subscribed to our channel, I want to invite you to subscribe to our channel on this button below. And besides this, there's a bell that you can activate, and then you will be informed when we upload new videos on this channel. Okay, I hope that the Lord may bless you through these videos. Give us a thumbs up, and the Lord bless you for the rest of the week.